I recognize that the gospel preacher at the Spring Congregation, one of them, that this could certainly fit under the obligation a preacher has to preach the whole counsel of God. But now that I'm serving as one of the elders, I know too this would certainly be the attitude of the shepherds of the flock regarding some of the things I'm going to deal with. I guess it's a twofold thing. And it's Christian stewardship. Christian stewardship. In general, a steward takes care of what belongs to someone else, taking care of it in the way and for the reason the owner wants it done. And that's an important point, because there's nobody going to heaven that is not a faithful Christian steward. So I look at Christian steward with the general definition in mind, and I realize that Christians take care of what belongs to God, which things God has placed within our care to take care of them in the way and for the reason that He wants it taken care of. Now, I said this morning in studying Matthew 6:33, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you," that was the foundation of everything that will motivate any of us to serve God, whether it's becoming a Christian or growing in service to God. Because a steward can't be faithful in his work unless he applies Matthew 6:33. And the truth of the matter is, anything that pertains to godly living is going to be undergirded by Matthew 6:33 and the first things first principle. You can see how growing out of this, or we may say just simply involved in it, intertwined in it, is Paul's statement to the church at Rome in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. He says, "I beseech you, therefore," the light of things preceding this, "brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." American Standard says spiritual service. Then he tells us, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." The point being that as a Christian steward, taking care of God's things, then my body, in fact, belongs to God. And the truth of the matter is, everything that we call our own, that we say is mine, and all other things belong to God. The psalmist said in Psalm 24, 1 and 2, "The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world, and all they that dwell therein. For He hath founded it upon the seas, and established it upon the floods." You see, if I'm going to be a Christian steward, if I'm going to seek first the kingdom of God, if I'm going to realize that the whole duty of man is to fear God and keep His commandments, if I'm going to be faithful, and only the faithful in the Lord's church are going to heaven, that is, those that are responsible to God, those that have sinned, and those that have recognized it and obeyed the gospel for the forgiveness of sins, they live faithful in the church. They're the only ones going to go to heaven. Nobody else is. I'm not talking about innocent and those not responsible for God, to God for their actions. I'm talking about those responsible to God. I want you to consider the great example of Christian stewardship as it's pictured to us by the Lord on the day that all men are brought before Him in the end of the world to be sentenced either for good or bad, to be judged. And if you begin at verse 14 in Matthew 25, notice how the Lord begins it. "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country." Now, the Lord, of course, left this earth, been gone for 2,000 years. We do not know when His second coming's going to be. There'll be nothing preceding it to announce to us, hey, tomorrow at 1 o'clock He'll be here. Nothing. He'll just come as a thief in the night. So He goes ahead and notice what He says. This man who went into a far country, who called His own servants and delivered unto them His goods. And delivered unto His servants His goods. Then He gets into the matter of what we study many times, the matter of the talents. And unto one He gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. To every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Now immediately you can see in understanding Christian steward and the general teaching of stewardship that he has left his goods, what belongs to him, in the care of somebody else. And they're to care for them as his goods, not theirs, according to his will. Now, what did they do, these who received the talents? Then he that received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. Likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. Now notice this. It's after a long time. You know, time doesn't mean anything regarding truth and the Lord's promises. Whether he comes an hour after he left or whether he comes 10,000 years after he left, he still is going to keep his promises. He's going to come. And what about those who have been left in charge of what belongs to him? And we've already seen, as far as God is concerned, everything belongs to him. Your house belongs to God. The clothes you're wearing right now belong to God. Whatever money you've got in the bank or the land you have, it all belongs to God. It's been put into our care. It's not to be used in a way contrary to God's will. Doesn't mean that we can't do with it and use it, but it's all got to be according to God's will, or else Colossians 3:17 is rather limited. And yet Colossians 3:17, whatsoever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father by Him. So what I'm trying to get you to focus on right now is that you don't have anything that really belongs to you. When you stand before the Lord in judgment and He says, give an account for this, you say, oh Lord, that belongs to me. It didn't belong to you. There's nothing the Bible teaches any such thing. It's simply been loaned into our care to use it according to His will. I just don't think many people think that way, even many people in the church. Or they do things a lot differently. When you connect that with Matthew 6:33, it certainly means that we would. Notice, and so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, Thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. And so on with the one who received the 2 and whatever. And he says to them, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. And remember, those few things already belonged to the Lord. And as a steward, they were required to take care of that as it belonged to him. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Now we've just seen how we're going to be judged, brethren. In the light of God's truth, the standard He's left us, then we're going to be judged as to how we have been stewards over what He has placed into our care. Parents, think about that when it comes to your children. Think about that, husbands, when you deal with your wife, and wives, as you deal with your husbands. Think about that when it comes specifically to the blood-bought body of Jesus Christ, the family of God, the kingdom of heaven. And we who make it up individually as to how we treat things spiritual. Of course, you see, when it comes down to the one person who had received less of the Lord's property than anybody else, the 1 talent man, notice this man's response. And the man's not condemned because he only had 1 talent. In other words, he had less of the Lord's materials that he had left in his care. That's not it at all. Notice what he said. Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not sowed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, thy wicked and slothful servant. Now let me pause here, because this ties directly into what many times I bring out in Matthew 6:33. What had this man done that was sinful? Not a thing. He had kept what his Lord had given him. He had given back what belonged to his Lord. Well, how is it that he's a wicked and slothful servant? He committed many sins of omission. He simply left undone what God expected him to do with what he had left in his charge. Does that tell you that whatever we are, as far as our bodies, our minds, everything else of a material nature that is put into our care, does that tell you what God expects of us? I mean, it's clear. You know what to expect when you stand before him in judgment. He tells you right here. And he tells us how he views people who leave undone what God obligates them to do. Thou wicked and slothful servant. Thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not and gathered where I have not strowed. Thou oughtest therefore, in the light of the fact of what you knew about me, to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. In other words, I'd received interest, at least. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath, because he hasn't used it. He hasn't taken care of it. He didn't appreciate it that the Lord put it into his hands for him to develop. The whole idea is, when you apply it to Christian living and growth in the church, it means you didn't use things to help you grow closer to God, to help you become more like Christ. And what happens to him? And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Gets rather serious that we learn to look at what God's placed into our hands, to take care of it the way the Lord wants us to. Now this sermon, the remainder of it, is not going to be dealing with the obligation that the church has, every one of us according to our several abilities, to preach the gospel to every creature, or to be involved in the benevolent activities of the church of helping other people when they can't help themselves, or to help the church come to a greater knowledge of the truth and to keep the church pure. All of that's very important. In fact, in some ways, it's more important than what I'm going to deal with in just a minute. And yet, what I'm going to deal with reflects really our attitude toward what has been put into our care by God. The late Brother J.D. Tant, back over 100 years ago or thereabouts, as many preachers at that time did, would preach very long gospel meetings and days, maybe many times twice a day. And they traveled throughout country, because most of the country they traveled in was where you had fundamentally farmers. A lot of times they didn't pay much attention to the building they met in for worship. Well, of course, a lot of people who don't know the Bible or anything about Christianity, the only way they get a picture of the church is they can see what the church meets in and the care of the church for what they meet in. Well, Brother Tant was supposed to be at a meeting in the afternoon, because they had 3 meetings that day. They had a Sunday afternoon meeting. And when it came time for Brother Tant, the church had assembled. Brother Tant wasn't there at that moment. I have no doubt that he calculated it this way. So they assembled and were wondering where he was and sang a song. And after a little while, when he even allowed the latecomers to come in, all of a sudden he comes walking down the aisle. And he looked like he had been under somebody's house trying to fix the plumbing. And he was noted for being quite eccentric in that way. But he entered the pulpit, his hair, what he had left, standing up all over his head and looking sort of disheveled, to say the least. And he had a fruit jar. Well, the people out here could see it was full of something. They didn't know what it was. And he began to talk like I've been talking about the church and how it reflects what it is to the community. They don't know the Bible. And he said, if you've wondered where I've been between services, I spent all the afternoon under the pews digging all of the gum that you've stuck under there out and filled up this. I just wanted you to know what you really thought about this building. And about the example you set before everybody else, you want to convert because you say you love their souls. Well, you see, back even in those days, folks... folks need a little teaching. You know, we are what we are because we are taught. And that's either we're wrong because we're taught wrong, or we're right because we're taught right. I want you to think, and I hope this will be received in the attitude that I've put it together, and with some help, by the way. And I told the elders what I was going to do. And they didn't get me down the floor and beat me over the head with a songbook or anything. I want you to consider how things apply to us and good stewardship taking care of these facilities. And we can't say we have somebody hired to do it, let them do it. Can't say that. There are plans even to renovate this auditorium in time, do a lot of things to it. But now, by the way we treat some things in this building and the one in the back, maybe we should ask, why should we? Are we good stewards in this area? Are we taking care of the Lord's property? Are we taking care of the Lord's facilities? We leave doors unlocked. I've been here a long time, and there's always been a big to-do over the doors unlocked. But we leave them unlocked. Somebody does. Oh, and we many times leave the alarm system not set, though it was set when somebody came here. Little things like the lights weren't on when we got here. We turned them on and we didn't turn them off when we left. Or the air conditioning or the heat, the case may be, are changed according to who's here. And as they leave, they never return it to their proper temps. Ken touched on some of that when he spoke some time ago regarding money and the taking care of money. And then, you know, that's a big thing to take care of money. Because you see, that money belongs to the Lord. You thought it's yours, but it belongs to the Lord. You thought only what you put in the plate belonged to the Lord, didn't you? And, of course, we would do well to do a little thinking along that line when we spend more from Monday through Saturday going to cafes and restaurants than we put in the plate on Sunday. Good stewardship is going to determine whether hell's our home or heaven is. In the kitchen, just recently this happened, the oven was left on 400. I'm not quite sure how long that it burned. If you had something there cooking, I'm sure it wasn't worth anything after a while. Or the warmer back there is left on, and is that good stewardship? Is that personal responsibility? Is that caring for the property? Remember, it's the Lord's building, and it's the Lord's grounds. In the kitchen, coffee pots are left on for days. Also, coffee pots are not washed or cleaned up. Then food's left out on the counter. We do make efforts to try to keep the vermin out, but somebody else is inviting them in. Dirty dishes are left in the sink, not washed. You ever get the idea this sounds like talking to teenagers? High chairs are used and food left on the tray and in the seat. They're seldom clean, just put back on the corner and food stuck to a tray and in the sea. Food smeared and trampled into the carpet and not cleaned. Now here's an interesting one. I found this, the elders saw it a while ago. On the door, or the outside door, just as you enter the building that goes into the library, somebody decided to put on a lot of lipstick and kiss that door at least three times. And they're big lips, too. Now, I don't know who's gotten in bad shape, but those lips are still there. I guess we could try to take like fingerprints of them, lip prints, and see if we could get everybody to come kiss a card and whatever. Brethren, that's hard to get off. You know, lipstick was made not to come off easy, and when you kiss a door, it stays on that white door. And if you want to see, it's back there now. Oh, fingernail clippings. They're found in various places. I've always thought over the years, preaching in places, sometimes I'd be preaching and I would pause and hear click, click. I keep hoping they'll kick it in the quick. And maybe, but what goes on in an auditorium is amazing. Classroom material is not put away or put back in the teacher supply room where it came from. So it's got to be searched out and hunted down and returned to proper place. Somebody has to do that. Some member of the church has to do that. Teachers don't return material or they don't clean up the classroom. And you'll have to know who you are that does this. I realize sometimes you can make some mistakes and overlook something. I'm not talking about that. We all make some mistakes, overlook something, or we forget something. But we're talking about things that are routine week in and week out. Tables and classrooms are not cleaned after using glue, glitter, markers, crayons. Maybe that's where the lipstick came from. Then the carpet gets damaged in the classroom from food, drinks, glue, hot glue, etc. We need to pay attention, and we need to be careful. That belongs to the Lord, you know. We never think about that much. We think of stewardship dealing with studying the Bible, teaching others, defending the faith. Well, the authority for a building, the authority even for grounds, for rent a building, own a building, lease a building, is because of the work of the church. This building and the facilities behind this auditorium are there because we have authority from God to have a place and to do things in that place, such as we're doing now, or to have Bible classes. Well, they need to be kept up. And that means you. And it means me. It's not some figment of somebody's imagination floating around here after we've all left, kissing the door. Children that are allowed to eat on the stairs, well, that might be all right, but then the food doesn't get cleaned up. And there it is for somebody to clean up. Then one that's been interesting over the years, are out here in the pews and other places, but I remember one somewhere down here many years ago. They had sat there, and I guess through more than one service, just rubbed the edge of their shoes over and over again. There was a black spot that big. I don't know how they had any soles on the shoes left. And thus, the floors are messed up, black marks, and you know, they're so easy to get up, and somebody has to get them up. And when it comes to candy, you'd be surprised the suckers are stuck under the pew pads. That kind of amazing, especially when I didn't get one. All kinds of food and drink left on the floor of the auditorium, in the songbook rack, on the pew. Drinks are spilled on the floor and on the carpet. They don't get cleaned up. All types of trash are dropped in around the building. Some of that's from folks around us, but we could be more careful with it. When I say folks around us, as you know, permission was given a long time ago for the folks over here to park under the trees. And sometimes some of those people and some who are their customers do things like that. That doesn't mean we can't talk to them about things. But you can't really expect of them what God expects of you and me. One of the things that I hate to find in a not that I search them out, because I'm sometimes afraid of what I'll find there, is dirty tissues in the back of those pews. I never knew we'd need to warn people about wearing rubber gloves before they worked in the song pew or song rack. You got classroom littered benches and songbook racks. You got things thrown again on the floor of the auditorium, in the restrooms. Kids bring stuff out, bring homes, and that's fine. If the parents don't want it, then they ought to quit stuffing it in the song rack or stashing it under the bench. You know, sometimes we've had the bums that are hanging out around here, and they've actually just recently camped out on the front out here and did a pretty good job setting up camp. We will not tell you some of the things that they that was left out there or packed out there that people had to find and probably need to put a hazmat suit on to be able to get rid of it. But sometimes we set up camp here in the auditorium in the pew that we dwell in. I haven't seen any tents yet, but we could be mindful of where we are. I think we could. It looks like sometimes maybe people are living in those benches. Obviously, after walking through the mud in the front of the building, instead of walking on concrete, the mud gets tracked into the building, and, you know, there's no better place to get the mud off your feet than when you're sitting there through the worship and just clean it all off your feet right there in the floor and pew you're sitting in. That seems reasonable, doesn't it? There are various items removed from their proper place. We'll say they've been borrowed, but they're never returned, such as tables, chairs, mop buckets, and so on. But it belongs to the Lord. Give it back to Him. Put it back the place it came from, the reason it's there. Somebody has to find it. Then there are items used from storage areas, like tablecloths and decorations, and they're not returned to the proper place. Items are thrown into closets or storage rooms without any, shall we say, rhyme or reason by the people that use them. Now, this is not some figment of my personal imagination when my blood pressure is real high. And it's pretty high right now. I ask for help from those that work on this building all the time, and I specifically ask, would you please give me a factual list of these things? But I tell you what I did know without that. My years of being here, just simply walking through the auditorium and looking and seeing with my very own eyes what anybody else can too, as well as other places in the building, what needs to be done. I'm not trying to be hateful and mean. I don't mind embarrassing somebody if it gets you to do what you know you're supposed to do in the first place. When we have visitors to our Bible classes and worship and lectureships and the like, how do we think this kind of treatment of the church's facilities, God's business and facilities, by Spring's own members impacts them? The Spring Church, including the elders, all of us do, need to realize how the church building and the grounds represent the Spring congregation to people who don't know the Bible, as I said earlier, or what Christianity is in the first place. As the old saying goes, people, you want to put your best foot forward. Well, surely we have a better foot to put forward. And I might say there are plans already to renovate this auditorium. It's going to be a while, but it's going to be changed considerably. For the better. But why should we do it if we're going to just go ahead and treat it like I've been mentioning, which are factual ways we, nobody else, have done it? And so if some are not very concerned about the state of these physical things that belong to God, the church uses for the reasons God said we should use it, it's no wonder that the same brethren are not concerned as they ought to be. Not that they're not concerned at all, but as they ought to be about the spiritual things that I mentioned that we're not necessarily dealing with in this sermon concerning stewardship. Brethren, many of us live in some very fine and expensive houses. And we would not tolerate those houses being treated or getting into the condition of the facilities of the Spring congregation or how it's treated, especially if it were your own family members doing it. In all honesty and in the sight of God, the teaching of God's word on Christian stewardship. And that we must give account to Jesus for our stewardship. In view of all of that, do you honestly think the Lord's pleased with the kind of thinking and conduct by church members regarding the physical facilities of the church that belongs to God to be used for the spreading of the gospel, the defense of the faith, the edification of the church, or anything else God's enjoined in specificity that the church is to do in the three areas where it's charged in saving souls? Preaching the gospel of the lost, the benevolence, and edifying the church. If so, I'd like to be there when you take your Bible and attempt to prove that God, your Heavenly Father, and Jesus, your Savior, is pleased with such treatment of what belongs to Him, and we as His children have treated it that way. In closing, I humbly ask, are you a faithful steward, seeing that God owns all things, and that He has put us in charge of caring for them as He desires them to be taken care of? Is it too much to ask of each one of us as children of God in the matter of these physical things that we pay attention to how we treat them and just follow the golden rule? Whatsoever ye would that men should do unto you, do ye even also unto them. It's very easy when you know, that doesn't belong to me. And that's what sometimes happens, whether the door's shut or locked or however what's done on the floor or whatever. Well, that's not mine. Somebody will take care of that. Do you do that at your own house? Maybe you do, but, well, we won't get into that. So in the light of this sermon and the one this morning, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, which emphasizes what ought to come first and foremost in our lives all the time, and that all things belong to God. Do you not see? Do you not see? There's a lot of room for making some necessary changes that we truly can in all things put first things first and be a Christian steward faithful to our calling, as the Bible teaches we must be if heaven's to be home. I doubt many people think that smearing something in the floor, not cleaning it up, or leaving something unlocked when it was locked would keep us out of heaven. But don't you realize that is a comment on the way you think, on your attitude, on your perspective of how you treat things that belong to somebody else? As I said, there's going to be, the Lord willing, renovations made to this auditorium. And when that time comes, as well as the back building, let us remember we are stewards of God to take care of what belongs to Him, and everything belongs to Him, and use it like the Lord wants it to be used. I humbly submit this to you, not trying to be whatever that's not good, but because it's just one of those things that we as human beings, members of the church, can let slip, cannot pay attention to when we need to, and it's a part of our Christian living. Now, if you're not a child of God, you haven't begun to be a steward. And you need to become a Christian. Nothing less, nothing more, nothing else. A member of the church that Jesus built. You do that by believing with all of your heart, based upon the Word of God, that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Romans 10:17. Then you must repent of all your sins. Acts 17:30. Then confess your faith in Christ as the Son of God, Romans 10:10, and complete your obedience to the gospel by being immersed in water by the authority of Christ in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit to obtain the remission of your sins. The Lord will add you to the church when you do that. Galatians 3:26-27, Acts 2:38, Romans 6:3-4, 1 Peter 3:21, Acts 22:16, and many more. Then you're ready to live a faithful life of a steward, growing and developing in the mind of Christ, the life of Christ, the grace of Christ, to become more like Him, that you will be fitted for heaven someday. And that involves taking care of whatever it is that God has put into our hands that He wants taken care of by us, whereby we prove to Him our love of Him, our love of the things that belong to Him, our love of the gospel primarily. As a child of God, if your conduct has not been that of a faithful steward, then whatever area it's in, would you repent of your sins humbly in God's second law of pardon for the unfaithful child of God? Come confessing those sins, we'll pray with you and for you. God has promised to forgive. Humbly, let us approach the study of His Word. With great meekness, let us carry it out. And let us all have long suffering one toward another and grow and develop in the love and mercy and grace and knowledge of God. If you're subject to the call of Jesus, then we ask you to come while we stand and sing.